Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Dyslexia, a very short introduction by Margaret J. Snowling, narrated by Heather Wilds. Chapter 1. Does Dyslexia Exist? Reading and writing are highly valued in almost all societies. Even as the use of technology for communications increases, this remains true. Poor reading will always be a problem, and there is no threat to the importance of literary skills in daily life. Literacy skills are fundamental for formal education, where so much of what we learn comes from printed texts. They are also part of the survival kit, which is needed to run our lives. When signing a lease, setting up a bank account, using an ATM, or reading a note sent home from school. It follows that difficulties with reading and writing have wide-ranging effects beyond academic achievement, including effects on career opportunities, personal well-being, and to some extent, mental health. Such difficulties are a problem not only for those affected, but also for society. Literacy difficulties, when they are not caused by lack of education, are known as dyslexia. Dyslexia can be defined as a problem with learning which primarily affects the development of reading accuracy and fluency and spelling skills. Dyslexia frequently occurs together with other difficulties, such as problems in attention, organization, and motor skills, movement. But these are not in and of themselves indicators of dyslexia. The difficulty which we now recognize as dyslexia was first described in the English-speaking world in 1896 by William Pringle Morgan, a general practitioner writing in the British Medical Journal. He wrote of a 14-year-old patient, Percy, which the boy spelled Precy, who was a bright and intelligent boy, quick at games and in no way inferior to others of his age. His great difficulty has been, and is now, his inability to learn to read. Following examination of Percy, who had no eye or visual defects and a good education to date, Pringle Morgan concluded that this was a case of congenital word blindness, literally the inability to store the visual images of words in memory. He hypothesized that this must be due to defective development of a region of the brain called the left angular gyrus. Interestingly, the boy was able to read figures normally and enjoyed arithmetic, so his problems appeared to be specific to literacy. Looking back, it is interesting how fitting this description was. As we shall hear, it is now widely held that dyslexia is a specific learning disorder. However, there is continuing debate regarding the boundaries of the disorder, its precise characterization, and even its name. Before we begin, we will look at three cases which place the story of dyslexia into a contemporary context. We will refer back to these cases frequently to illustrate the many features of this developmental condition and our understanding of it. Bobby. Bobby is a 7-year-old boy who is verbally bright but struggling to learn to read. He is the first child in his family, and although he was a late talker, his parents did not worry because he was very communicative. When Bobby began to talk, he was difficult to understand, and the family were often amused by the strange words he made up to refer to things. It was only when Bobby went to school that his difficulties became obvious. Although he had known some letters and even some words in preschool, he had not been able to master phonics. He did not do at all well in the phonics checks conducted by his teacher at the end of year one, and his writing, although well-formed, was minimal, and his spellings mostly difficult to decipher. He was placed in a special catch-up group in his class, in an attempt to bring his reading on, and, although classmates in the same group progressed well, Bobby did not. Rather, he began to fall further and further behind his peers, and his behavior began to deteriorate. Misha. Misha is a 10-year-old girl who has struggled with reading since starting school. Her parents are worried because she will soon be transferring to secondary school, and they fear she will not be able to cope with the literacy demands. Misha has received two lots of intervention, remedial reading within school and has progressed quite well in both reading and writing. However, her reading is still slow and effortful. Because she has to expend a lot of energy on decoding words on the page, she finds it difficult also to pay attention to what she is reading. Not surprisingly, she gets little enjoyment from reading. Misha is very creative and loves writing and illustrating stories. In fact, this is one of her favorite pastimes. Yet her spelling is poor, and she does not get credit for what is, in all other respects, excellent work. Misha is becoming increasingly anxious about her performance and beginning to say she doesn't want to go to school. Harry. Harry is a 30-year-old man who has made his career in the food industry, primarily in marketing. He has great ideas for branding and advertising, and he is a superb salesman. Harry says that he has struggled academically throughout his life. He was assessed for dyslexia at 9 years of age and had a lot of extra help with reading and spelling, both from his parents and from a tutor. As a young adult, he avoids literacy-related tasks. Indeed, that is why he has chosen to be a salesman, but he struggles to complete forms, invoices, and tax returns. Harry avoids reading at all costs, saying he's only ever read one book, Like a Virgin, by Richard Branson. He writes when he has to, mainly lists. Lists of things to do and not to forget. He would say that it is his memory and organizational skills that let him down most, not his literacy. These three cases provide a sense of what it is like to be dyslexic. The nature of dyslexia changes with age, and the symptoms experienced appeared to shift too. Nonetheless, at the core of the problem is a difficulty in decoding words for reading and encoding them for spelling. Fluency in this process is never achieved. Further, the condition persists in spite of the provision of extra help. The three cases also illustrate co-occurring problems. For Bobby, some conduct difficulties. For Misha, anxiety. And for Harry, problems of memory, attention, and organization. Such additional difficulties are common, but whether they are a consequence of dyslexia or have a different origin is not yet fully understood. The medical model of dyslexia. During the early years of the 20th century, the study of congenital word blindness was taken up by eye specialists like James Hinchelwood, a contemporary of William Pringle Morgan, who described cases adhering to what was to become the medical model of dyslexia. These clinicians viewed congenital word blindness as a discrete condition with a specific set of signs and symptoms. However, this conceptualization of reading difficulties began to change in the 1930s, following the landmark publication Disorders of Speech, Language, Reading and Spelling by the American neuropathologist Dr. Samuel T. Orton. Orton had a very important insight. He noticed that poor reading runs in families and that other family members often have problems of speech or language, including stammering. He went on to link these observations to incomplete brain lateralization, the tendency of one side of the brain to specialize in certain cognitive functions, and in turn, with the frequent letter and word reversals associated with dyslexia. Since visual information was understood to arrive in the dominant hemisphere in the correct orientation, while the exact mirror image was received in the non-dominant hemisphere, it was important to suppress the confusing image if reading was to proceed normally. He believed a child who had not established brain dominance would be unable to suppress the mirror image, and there would be continuing confusion between symbols, particularly reversible ones like B and D. He used the term strephosymbolia, literally twisting of symbols, to describe the condition. While his theory was incorrect, as is the related idea that dyslexia is associated with left-handedness, his observations about family traits hold true and, as will be heard, these do indeed help us to understand the causal pathways that lead to dyslexia. However, Orton has been remembered not for his theory, but for the practice which originated in his clinic in Boston in the 1930s. Here, two talented educators, Anna Gillingham and Bessie Stillman, pioneered methods for remediating reading difficulties. They worked from the assumption that the cause of reading difficulties was the failure to memorize the sequences of letters in words. So, the task was to establish memory representations for these, without having to rely on faulty visual processes. The approach they developed uses all three sensory modalities, visual, auditory, and kinesthetic, movement, to reinforce new concepts during learning and to circumvent the basic deficit, a strategy described as multisensory teaching. But the approach involves much more. Children are taught explicitly how the writing system works by mapping letters and letter sequences to sounds, thereby building up knowledge of letter-sound correspondences, spelling patterns, and rules. The successful Orton-Gillingham-Stillman approach is still known worldwide and has influenced generations of specialist dyslexia teachers. Its various incarnations, e.g. in the UK, Alpha to Omega and the Hickey method, are at the heart of many interventions used today for children with dyslexia. Orton's followers continue to train teachers in methods for teaching children with reading difficulties, and in the 1960s, the word dyslexia came into use in the UK to describe these children. Dyslexia was coined by the German ophthalmologist Rudolf Berlin, derived from dys, bad, abnormal, difficult, and lexis, speech. Apparently, because of confusion at the time between Greek, legen, to speak, and Latin, legere, to read. Even though it was accepted that the intervention required for dyslexia was educational, a medical model of referral and treatment was propagated in the UK and elsewhere. Thus, parents sought a diagnosis before teaching began. Foremost among the influential diagnosticians was Dr. MacDonald Critchley, a neurologist at the National Hospital in London, who saw children in his clinic and subsequently referred them for treatment. In 1963, just around the corner from this clinic, the Word Blind Centre opened, bringing together a team comprising doctors, psychologists, teachers, and speech therapists to assess and teach dyslexic children. Among those working in the centre were two pioneers, Professor Tim Miles and Dr. Sanjay Naidu, who each wrote an influential book which would take dyslexia research in a more scientific direction. The Word Blind Centre became known for its expertise, and parents would travel many miles to have their children assessed and to receive special lessons, usually once a week. Despite these advances, dyslexia began to attract a reputation as a disorder of the middle classes and, increasingly, its existence was dismissed by education professionals. This was a sorry state of affairs. It was true that it was primarily more educated parents who found their way to centres which would diagnose dyslexia, but this was more about those parents' awareness of the condition than about their children's needs. Regrettably, the needs of children with severe reading and spelling difficulties were often neglected. What was required was a study using robust methodology, which could characterize such children and assess their response to teaching. A study of the health, education, and behavior of all 9 to 10-year-olds living on the Isle of Wight during the 1960s provided such evidence. Dyslexia, or specific learning disorder. The Isle of Wight population study was groundbreaking. All 2,334 of the 9 to 11-year-old children living on the island were surveyed using a wide variety of measures. The aim was to establish the prevalence of childhood disorders of health and well-being, including psychiatric conditions and learning disorders. As part of this study, Michael Rutter, Bill Yule, and their colleagues assessed the children's educational attainments and related them to IQ. This procedure allowed the differentiation of children with low levels of reading attainment commensurate with lower levels of cognitive ability from children with more specific difficulties who were, at that time, considered to be dyslexic. It is important to describe some features of the methods they used. All children were assessed using the Wechsler Intelligence Scale for Children, WISC, which provides measures of verbal, nonverbal, performance, and full-scale IQ. The children also completed a reading assessment in which they read aloud short passages and answered questions they were asked about them. The test provided measures of reading accuracy, reading rate, and reading comprehension. There was a moderately strong relationship between IQ and reading attainment in the sample, a correlation of about 0.6. In other words, children of higher ability were typically better at reading, in terms of both accuracy and comprehension. The researchers then applied a statistical approach using data from the population sample to predict the expected reading attainment of every child given their IQ. Once these expected scores had been derived, it was possible to compare them with the actual scores the children obtained and, then, to identify children whose attained reading score fell significantly below expectation. The children so identified had specific reading difficulties, described at the time as specific reading retardation. The critical question was, did these children look like those described by the medical model as dyslexic? To answer this question, the research team compared the children with specific reading difficulties with equally poor readers from the sample, but in this case, those whose poor reading was in line with expectation, given their lower cognitive ability. We will call them low-ability poor readers. To put it another way, to investigate the concept of dyslexia, they compared unexpectedly poor readers with expectedly poor readers. The findings from this comparison were salutary. There were relatively few differences between the children with specific reading difficulties and the children who were low-ability poor readers. It wasn't that one group looked dyslexic and the other group just slow. Indeed, there was no evidence to support the soft neurological signs agreed to be associated with dyslexia by a meeting of the World Congress of Neurology in 1968. Nevertheless, the group differences were informative. Among children with specific reading difficulties, more boys were affected than girls, a ratio of about 3-1, and a history of delays and difficulties with speech and language was common in this group. In contrast, approximately equal numbers of boys and girls were low-ability poor readers, and they had experienced a wide range of developmental delays and difficulties, not only with speech and language, but also in motor coordination. Arguably, of most importance, the progress of the two groups over 2 years differed. A follow-up study revealed that the children with specific reading problems had actually made less progress in basic reading skills than the low-ability poor readers, despite being of higher intelligence. Thus, the Isle of Wight study presented some of the earliest evidence that children with specific reading difficulties show a poor response to reading instruction. In more recent times, response to intervention has been proposed as a better way of identifying likely dyslexic difficulties than measured reading skills. And as we shall hear, the approach to defining reading problems on the basis of a discrepancy between IQ and reading attainment has fallen from favor. Dyslexia defies definition. The findings of the Isle of Wight study were influential in clarifying the fact that the problem of specific reading difficulties was a real one. In Britain, the term specific learning difficulties came into being while learning disabilities was used in the US. But what became of the concept of dyslexia? A Google search for the term dyslexia receives 11 million hits. Specific learning difficulties, half as many. Indeed, the definition of dyslexia continues to be debated, though the term remains in general use. To this day, there is tension between the medical model of dyslexia and the understanding of specific learning difficulties in educational circles. The nub of the problem for the concept of dyslexia is that, unlike measles or chickenpox, it is not a disorder with a clear diagnostic profile. Rather, reading skills are distributed normally in the population, a statistical term meaning that reading, like weight or height, varies continuously, with the majority of people being in the average range. And there is no boundary between dyslexia and normal reading. Nonetheless, if children have difficulties decoding print, this will be an obstacle to reading with understanding, which, in turn, is a significant barrier to educational achievement. So we can ask, why does the concept of dyslexia survive? One reason is that there are many children who struggle significantly with learning to read and write, and who require educational support. And there are many reports that without this support, these children experience a downward spiral of low achievement and poor self-esteem, perhaps leading also to the issues with emotional and behavioral adjustment observed in the three cases introduced earlier. The point of labeling these children, then, is to communicate their educational needs and to provide interventions, basically to flag the need for an intervention to support their literacy skills. Moreover, since learning disorders persist across the lifespan, the dyslexia label can signal the need for appropriate arrangements to be put in place, not just at school, but also in the workplace. Indeed, it is important to ensure that people such as Harry do not struggle with the literacy demands associated with a career to which they are otherwise well suited. In this respect, dyslexia is like high blood pressure. There is no precise cutoff between high blood pressure and normal blood pressure. But if high blood pressure remains untreated, the risk of complications is high. Hence, a diagnosis of hypertension is warranted. And this, in turn, leads to recommendations of medication and possibly other interventions. There is not the same approach to thinking about dyslexia. There are no agreed cut-off criteria and few evidence-based treatments. However, this book will show that there is remarkable agreement among researchers regarding the risk factors for poor reading and a growing number of evidence-based interventions. Dyslexia definitely exists, and we can do a great deal to ameliorate its effects. Chapter 1. Does dyslexia exist? Reading and writing are highly valued in almost all societies. Even as the use of technology for communications increases, this remains true. Poor reading will always be a problem, and there is no threat to the importance of literary skills in daily life. Literacy skills are fundamental for formal education, where so much of what we learn comes from printed texts. They are also part of the survival kit, which is needed to run our lives. When signing a lease, setting up a bank account, using an ATM, or reading a note sent home from school, it follows that difficulties with reading and writing have wide-ranging effects beyond academic achievement, including effects on career opportunities, personal well-being, and to some extent, mental health. Such difficulties are a problem not only for those affected, but also for society. Literary difficulties, when they are not caused by lack of education, are known as dyslexia. Dyslexia can be defined as a problem with learning which primarily affects the development of reading accuracy and fluency and spelling skills. Dyslexia frequently occurs together with other difficulties, such as problems in attention, organization, and motor skills, movement. But these are not in and of themselves indicators of dyslexia. The difficulty which we now recognize as dyslexia was first described in the English-speaking world in 1896 by William Pringle Morgan, a general practitioner writing in the British Medical Journal. He wrote of a 14-year-old patient, Percy, which the boy spelled Precy, who was a bright and intelligent boy, quick at games, and in no way inferior to others of his age. His great difficulty has been, and is now, his inability to learn to read. Following examination of Percy, who had no eye or visual defects and a good education to date, Pringle Morgan concluded that this was a case of congenital word blindness, literally the inability to store the visual images of words in memory. He hypothesized that this must be due to defective development of a region of the brain called the left angular gyrus. Interestingly, the boy was able to read figures normally and enjoyed arithmetic, so his problems appeared to be specific to literacy. Looking back, it is interesting how fitting this description was. As we shall hear, it is now widely held that dyslexia is a specific learning disorder. However, there is continuing debate regarding the boundaries of the disorder, its precise characterization, and even its name. Before we begin, we will look at three cases which place the story of dyslexia into a contemporary context. We will refer back to these cases frequently to illustrate the many features of this developmental condition and our understanding of it. Bobby. Bobby is a 7-year-old boy who is verbally bright but struggling to learn to read. He is the first child in his family, and although he was a late talker, his parents did not worry because he was very communicative. When Bobby began to talk, he was difficult to understand, and the family were often amused by the strange words he made up to refer to things. It was only when Bobby went to school that his difficulties became obvious. Although he had known some letters and even some words in preschool, he had not been able to master phonics. He did not do at all well in the phonics checks conducted by his teacher at the end of year one, and his writing, although well-formed, was minimal, and his spellings mostly difficult to decipher. He was placed in a special catch-up group in his class, in an attempt to bring his reading on, and, although classmates in the same group progressed well, Bobby did not. Rather, he began to fall further and further behind his peers, and his behavior began to deteriorate. Misha. Misha is a 10-year-old girl who has struggled with reading since starting school. Her parents are worried because she will soon be transferring to secondary school, and they fear she will not be able to cope with the literacy demands. Misha has received two lots of intervention, remedial reading within school, and has progressed quite well in both reading and writing. However, her reading is still slow and effortful. Because she has to expend a lot of energy on decoding words on the page, she finds it difficult also to pay attention to what she is reading. Not surprisingly, she gets little enjoyment from reading. Misha is very creative and loves writing and illustrating stories. In fact, this is one of her favorite pastimes. Yet her spelling is poor, and she does not get credit for what is, in all other respects, excellent work. Misha is becoming increasingly anxious about her performance and beginning to say she doesn't want to go to school. Harry. Harry is a 30-year-old man who has made his career in the food industry, primarily in marketing. He has great ideas for branding and advertising, and he is a superb salesman. Harry says that he has struggled academically throughout his life. He was assessed for dyslexia at 9 years of age and had a lot of extra help with reading and spelling, both from his parents and from a tutor. As a young adult, he avoids literacy-related tasks. Indeed, that is why he has chosen to be a salesman, but he struggles to complete forms, invoices, and tax returns. Harry avoids reading at all costs, saying he's only ever read one book, Like a Virgin, by Richard Branson. He writes when he has to, mainly lists. Lists of things to do and not to forget. He would say that it is his memory and organizational skills that let him down most, not his literacy. These three cases provide a sense of what it is like to be dyslexic. The nature of dyslexia changes with age, and the symptoms experienced appeared to shift too. Nonetheless, at the core of the problem is a difficulty in decoding words for reading and encoding them for spelling. Fluency in this process is never achieved. Further, the condition persists in spite of the provision of extra help. The three cases also illustrate co-occurring problems. For Bobby, some conduct difficulties. For Misha, anxiety. And for Harry, problems of memory, attention, and organization. Such additional difficulties are common, but whether they are a consequence of dyslexia or have a different origin is not yet fully understood. The medical model of dyslexia. During the early years of the 20th century, the study of congenital word blindness was taken up by eye specialists like James Hinchelwood, a contemporary of William Pringle Morgan, who described cases adhering to what was to become the medical model of dyslexia. These clinicians viewed congenital word blindness as a discrete condition with a specific set of signs and symptoms. However, This conceptualization of reading difficulties began to change in the 1930s, following the landmark publication Disorders of Speech, Language, Reading and Spelling by the American neuropathologist Dr. Samuel T. Orton. Orton had a very important insight. He noticed that poor reading runs in families and that other family members often have problems of speech.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.